Welcome to EPG Pathshala. This is the second chapter regarding to biodiversity and environment conservation. Biodiversity and environmental conservation, these are interlinked subjects, or we can say that these are interallied subjects, and they can be treated as synonyms, as the conservation of biodiversity will eventually have a positive effect on environmental conservation. Biodiversity defines the variation at three levels. First is genetic, second is species, and third is ecosystem level. The distribution of biodiversity is uneven and is concentrated more at the tropical forest and hot spots. The nature has created a balance between the biodiversity and the ecosystem that includes all form of life from aerial to land dwellers and marine life forms. This chapter of biodiversity and environment conservation is entirely dedicated to discuss the environmental conservation aspect of biodiversity in brief, and all these are discussed in detail in the different modules of this paper. Now, I will define a term that is keystone species. There was a geologist named as Robert T. Payne. He coined the term keystone species. Students, keystone species is a species or an organism that defines an entire ecosystem. If it is absent from the ecosystem, it can cause an ecosystem to change, or the entire ecosystem can cease to exist. They have low functional redundancy, which means if a species disappears, if this keystone species disappears, then no other species present in the ecosystem could replace them, thus leaving a void in the ecological niche. Hence, the ecosystem would exert a radical change and allow new invasive species to populate the habitat. I have already discussed in the previous module what are invasive or alien species. Now, any living organism can be a keystone species. It doesn't need that it should be bigger or smaller in size, or it should be abundant or less. Nevertheless, practically, most of the examples for this type have enormous influence on the food web, and it varies from habitat to habitat. If the keystone species are expelled from an ecosystem, then a negative set of changes will be triggered. Now we will take an example, and that example is the overpopulation of one species, which led to the disappearance of other species. A well-documented case of such a chain of events was the elimination of wolves from the Yellowstone National Park at the beginning of the last century. The negative effect on the national park's biodiversity was so profound that authorities have taken steps to introduce this keystone predator back. Now, International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources categorizes these threatened species in Red Data Book. It intentionally made as a straightforward system for classification of species who are at high risk of global extinction. The mainstream focus is to provide a direct and unbiased framework where species are broadly classified on their extinction risk. Even though the red data gives the list of species who are at high risk, they still are not the only party to provide priorities for conservational measures. IUCN classifies its threatened species under three categories. First are critically endangered. A taxon is considered to be critically endangered when the species is facing extreme danger of becoming extinct in the wild. Then comes endangered species. Endangered species are those species that are facing a very high risk of extinction in the wild. Thereafter comes vulnerable species. Those species are said to be vulnerable if they are facing a high risk of extinction in the wild in the nearby future. Then comes red data books. list of threatened flora and fauna in Indian Sumatran includes rhinoceros, Hangul deer, Himalayan brown or red bear, pygmy hawk, Andaman white-tooth shrew, then Condona soft-furred rat, Elvira rat, large rocklet, Namdaepa flying squirrel, Malabar large-spotted civet, Asiatic wild dog, and red panda. Wild ass, brown antlered deer, golden langur, white-bellied musk deer, Indian hawk deer, hispid hare, Assam rabbit, lion-tailed macaw, Tibetan antelope, Nilgiri langur, all these are included in red data book that depicts the list of endangered species. Thereafter comes Nilgiri tahar, Ganges river dolphin, that is known, also known as Platanista gangetica. Now, this was the list of the threatened fauna species. Now comes the list of threatened flora species. Flora means plant and fauna means animals. Now, it includes milkwort, Assam catkin yew, wart's foot, moa, skeleton, fog fern and whisk fern, umbrella tree, kudai whale, Indian mallow, Athivala, tuthi, Ivoni tree, Malabar lily, spider wort, Malayavaram, Malaburam, Jimikanda, Musli. Musli is also known as Chlorophytum tuberosum. Next list is the list of endangered and endemic species of India. First, we should have a knowledge what is endangered species or threatened species. Any organism, whether it is a plant, it is an animal, it is a microorganism, who is in prompt danger of undergoing biological extinction is defined as endangered species or threatened species. In India, this is the data regarding to India. In India, it is estimated that around 450 plant species, 100 mammals and 150 bird species are endangered. India's biodiversity is threatened primarily due to destruction of habitat, degradation of habitat and over-exploitation of natural resources and other causes I have earlier explained in the biodiversity and environment conservation part 1. Red data book contains a list of endangered species of plants and animals that might become extinct in the nearby future if these species are not protected. Some of the endangered and endemic species found in India include fish. In fish, these are knife-tooth sawfish, Asian arowana, red-lined torpedo barb, golden mahseer. Bird species include steppe eagle, great knot, masked finfoot, greater adjutant, white-bellied blue robin, Nilgiri blue robin, white-headed duck, narcondom, hornbill, green peafowl, spotted green shank, banasura, laughing thrush. Reptiles category that includes endangered and endemic species include parrotted vine snake, three-striped roofed turtle, green turtle, Indian narrow-headed soft-shell turtle, gone day gecko, vianet day gecko, keeled box turtle, Bollinger's Dacia, Puna skink, Inger's mabua, yellow-headed tortoise, Asian forest tortoise, Indian kangaroo lizard, Assam roofed turtle, Asian giant soft-shell turtle, Travancore hills thorn-tailed snake, Travancore earth snake, Cochin forest cane turtle. Mammals that are included in endangered and endemic list are red panda, sea whale, blue whale, fin whale, venteng. Venteng is also known as Bos javanicus. It is its scientific name. Then comes wild water buffalo, hispid hare, dhole, Indian elephant, woolly flying squirrel, polar leaf-nosed bat, loin-tailed macaw. Loin-tailed macaw is important. Its scientific name is Macaca silenus. Then comes white-bellied musk deer, servant house, Mengele's mouse-eared bat, Nilgiri tahar, The scientific name of Asiatic lion is Panthera leo persica. The scientific name of Bengal tiger is Panthera tigris tigris. Ganges river dolphin, Platanista gangetica gangetica. Geese golden langur, Nicobar tree shrew. So I am telling the scientific names of these mammals since they are important and they come in competitive question. Next comes, I have discussed the scientific name of Asiatic lion, Bengal tiger and dolphin as these are important from the competitive point of view. Then comes the uncontrollable encroachment into wildlife zone. Thus stopping the movement of wildlife is a reason behind the extinction of the biodiversity. Every year, countless number of humans and animals die. What's the reason? The only reason is the encroachment into wildlife zone. A few cases of this conflict are humans die due to leopard attack, due to tiger attack, due to attack by elephant and bear. These attacks lead to animal deaths, loss of crops, loss of human life, wildlife injury, degradation of the livestock, destruction of geographic land, and considerable reduction in wildlife population. Now, what can be done to reduce the risks of these conflicts? These conflicts can be reduced by taking measures like electric fencing should be done near the wildlife zone, agricultural land, not stepping beyond the buffer zone, planning should be done, and livestock protection, community-based natural resource management should be carried out. Ecotourism should be supported. Those crops should be grown that are disliked by the wildlife. A classical example is seen where red pepper is grown along with other crops. It is grown so that the elephants are kept away due to a fact that elephants don't like these crops and avoids crops that contain capsaicin. Now, the next topic is the strategies for the conservation of biodiversity. First strategy is to maintain the flawless or we can say viable landscape. The aim of this strategy is to provide protection along with priority actions such as repair historic impacts or removal of those threats and improve the ecological integrity by maintaining long-term viability of the more intact landscapes of the region. Then next is the reverse declines. Here the strategy involves in bringing back the lost ecological site so as to reinitiate the original ecological site or critical ecological processes by improving the habitat of shrubby systems and open woodland and eventually help in bringing back the declining species or those species that are on the verge of extinction. Next is to recover threatened species and ecological communities. The aim of this strategy is to fortify the preservation of species, those species that are on the verge of extinction in the wild, thus indirectly protecting ecosystems from failing. The work here is done not at community level. I'm telling you that the work is done not at community level, but it is done on individual species as each has their own unique requirements for the survival process. The actions are based on implementing measures for increasing their distribution and abundance while trying to put a stop to their declining rate and emerging threats. The aim is to educate people of those threats that are knocking at the door before the final extinction happens. It means we have to tell the people the various causes why the biodiversity is getting extincted. Some of the threats are climate change and the introduction of invasive species. Here I would like to introduce one more point that humans are mainly responsible for the extinction of the biodiversity. The submissive adaptation to improve the elasticity of natural system and allowing them to adapt to change can be done by various activities such as by maintaining functional areas and ensuring that there are representatives for the environments and that the associated processes for removing and minimizing existing stressors are done. Active adaptation can be done by influencing ecological processes to moderately direct the nature of adaptation by activities like restoring habitats and system dynamics, identifying and protecting climate refugees, and managing restoring connectivity by increasing the matrix permeability and functional connectivity. Transformation can be done to fundamentally alter ecological processes in an aim to prevent irreversible changes from happening. The relevant activities would include keystone structuring of revised system, eco-engineering and transformation, and species translocation or ex situ conservation, that is genetic preservation. I have already explained it in the previous module. Then there comes conservation prioritization. First is spatial conservation prioritization. It is about identifying priority areas for biodiversity as well as the allocation and scheduling of alternative conservation actions to inform decision making. In other words, spatial conservation prioritization tries to answer the question of where, when, and how we act to efficiently meet conservation goals. Efficiency is an important concept, as possible conservation actions are always limited by the available resources. It can be informative for many different types of conservation action, such as selecting locations most suitable for extending the protected area network, targeting the restoration management, or designing broad-scale green infrastructure. Now, what do you understand by the term quantitative? It refers to the prioritization based on quantitative and spatial explicit data that describes the extent and occurrence of biodiversity features, including species and habitats and other relevant information, including costs and threats. A prioritization algorithm then does the actual prioritization by ordering the planning units used according to some explicit formulation, and the results are usually presented in the form of maps. These maps, they describe the spatial distribution of priorities over the area of interest. Tools aimed at quantitative spatial conservation prioritization have multiple advantages over non-quantitative approaches. Now, what are the advantages? They are able to account for the occurrence of biodiversity over potentially very broad geographical areas. Now, let us take an example. When working with species on local level, it is very, very important to account for the occurrence of that species somewhere else. When designing new protected areas, it is important to know what is already has been protected. Ecological connectivity is yet another factor that is not easy to account for in conventional planning. Expert-based and quantitative approaches are not, however, mutually exclusive. Expert input is always needed. That is, we always need experts to make use of quantitative spatial conservation planning tools. Next approach for the conservation of biodiversity is biotechnological approach. It is generally believed that biotechnology has always adverse effects on biodiversity. But in fact, biotechnology offers new means of improving the biodiversity. For example, I have discussed about cryopreservation. It comes under the biotechnology term. Seed banks are the most efficient and effective method of ex situ conservation for the majority of endangered species. In seed banks, genetic fingerprints are used to establish the origin of a seed or the relatedness of one plant variety to other. Next is tissue culture technique. It is of great interest for the collection, multiplication, and storage of plant germplasm. This is a very, very old technique. Such techniques, they allow the propagation of the plant material with high multiplication rates in an aseptic environment. Micropropagation refers to in vitro mass production. In vitro means under laboratory condition. Every work has to be done in the lab. Mass production of whole plant from a small tissue. That tissue can be a root cell, shoot cell, or meristematic cell. Through micropropagation, allied clonal material can be very rapidly multiplied. DNA barcoding is another technique in which species are identified and performed by using DNA sequences from a small fragment of the genome, that is gene, with the aim of contributing to a wide range of ecological and conservation studies in which traditional taxonomic identification is not practical. Thereafter comes the another approach, that is the in vitro production of embryos. The embryos now have to be produced in the lab. In vitro embryo is production is another way for biodiversity conservation. Now, why embryos have to be produced in lab condition to ensure the embryo rescue? Methods used in the production of embryos in vitro include splitting and cloning of embryos, their selection by markers, sexing of embryos, and transfer of new genes. New genes means genes that we require to transfer into that embryo, gene of interest. Then embryo culture and transfer technique is used to introduce fertilized embryos into surrogate mothers. Sometimes closely related species can be used to produce the offspring of an endangered species. Next comes the production of transgenic crops and animals via biotechnology. This also plays an important role in biodiversity conservation. Transgenic crops are likely to increase the agricultural biodiversity and it helps to maintain the native biodiversity rather than to endanger it. Such crops may prove to be very useful to the farmers and they can be of commercial value. I would give some 2 to 3 examples like BT cotton, BT brinjal and soya bean. They have been, scientists are trying to work to grow them in India by the use of biotechnological technique. However, the practical benefits and risks of the crops need to be assessed in the field and their products need to be scrutinized. In case of animals, several lines of transgenic farm animals have been produced, but none of them have been commercialized till now. Some lines are made for the pharmaceutical industries so as to produce drugs in their milk. Others may show improved resistance towards certain infections. Now, biotechnological methods have many advantages to conventional captive breeding procedures. Since the animals need not to be moved around, less stress is experienced and the problem of space for keeping the animals is also solved since samples can be taken in the wild. Since the animals need to be moved around, less stress is experienced and the problem of space for keeping the animals is also solved. Since samples can be taken only in the wild, storage of genetic resources will help to preserve the biodiversity and will counter the effect of genetic drift on smaller populations. Even if an animal dies, its genes will still be available for future breeding work. Biodiversity conservation policies and programs. National and international biodiversity conservation policies and programs include International Union for the Conservation of Nature. It helps the government at national level by preparing some policies at national level, whereas it provides advice to environmental conventions such as the Convention on Biological Diversity, CITES, and the Framework Convention on Climate Change in an international level. It also counsels the UNESCO on natural world heritage. There is a formally accredited permanent observer mission to United Nations in New York. It has been stated in their website that they are the only international observer organization in the United Nations General Assembly with proficiency regarding issues concerning the environment, specifically biodiversity, nature conservation, and sustainable natural resource use. It has solemn relations with the following: Council of Europe, FAO, Food and Agricultural Organization of United Nations, IMO, International Maritime Organization, Organization of American States, OAS, UNCTAD, United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, United Nations Environment Program, UNESCO, United Nations, UNESCO, the full form of UNESCO is very important, United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, WIPO, it's also important, World Intellectual Property Organization, and WMO, it is also of very important, World Meteorological Organization. Now next come the Habitat Conservation Plan, how the habitat can be conserved. It is a permit that has been included in the application for an incidental take permit that is issued under ESA, United States Endangered Species Act, to exclusive establishments that undertake projects that could lead to an outcome of annihilation of an endangered or threatened species. It is a planning document that ensures that the anticipated take of a listed species will be minimized or mitigated by conserving the habitat upon which the species depend, thereby contributing to the recovery of the species as a whole. The environmental community and landowners take different strands on HCPs. Following are the strengths. Flexible to accommodate a wide range of projects that vary greatly in size and scope. Forces reconsideration or consideration of species by all parties and reduce uncertainty for landowners. Weaknesses are inflexible with regards to changing knowledge relating to species and habitat. No surprise policies has been highly controversial, with critics arguing that it burdens the agencies rather than landowners with additional financial and mitigation responsibilities if unforeseen circumstances arise. HCPs are viewed as having weak, insufficient monitoring plans. HCPs means Habitat Conservation Plan. Additionally, the parties responsible for monitoring the Habitat Conservation Plan are not regulated in a systematic manner due to the private funding. Criticism over scientific standards and limited credible scientific data is also there. There are certain agencies that have interpreted the role of Habitat Conservation Plan under Section 10A of ESA as a means to contribute to survival of species, but not as a recovery tool. The Habitat Conservation Planning Handbook that is inconsistent with this stand and states that contribution to recovery is often an integral product of an HCP, and in general, conservation plans that are not consistent with recovery plan objectives should be discouraged. Next come Convention on Biodiversity. Convention on Biodiversity, CBD, is an international agreement. Students, this is a very important point, that this agreement was adopted at Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, and this question is often asked in competitive questions. It has three main objectives. First objective is to conserve biological diversity, use its components in a sustainable way, to share fairly and equitably the benefits arising from the use of genetic resources. CBD was negotiated, that is Convention on Biological Diversity, was negotiated under the guidance of the United Nations and was signed by more than 150 government leaders. This number, that is 150 countries, it is very important. It was signed by government leaders at the Rio Earth Summit, whose official denomination is the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development. Keep remember that Rio Earth Summit is also known as United Nations Conference on Environment and Development. Now, the convention is one of the most widely ratified international treaties on environmental issues with 194 member countries. Now, I think one more member country has been added and the number has reached to 195. You have to check it out on the internet. Unlike other international agreements that set compulsory targets and obligations, the CBD takes a flexible approach to implement rules and regulation. It identifies general goals, policies, and countries are free to determine how they want to implement those plans. One of the greatest achievement of conservation convention on biological diversity so far has been to generate an enormous amount of interest in biodiversity, which is a critically important environment and developmental issue both in developed and developing countries. Therefore, at the last, I would like to conclude the module as the biodiversity and environmental conservation are interrelated and dependent on each other. Both of them need to be carried side by side so that the natural balance can be maintained or it can be created. The extent of human interference that has created disturbance in the distribution of biodiversity on the planet, it should be reduced. That is, anthropogenic activity should be reduced. This has also led to the extinction of many species and enlisted many in endangered and vulnerable categories. Although authorities at national and international level, they are taking up several programs, they are making several efforts to reduce the conflict, still a lot needs to be done to maintain the equilibrium between the man and nature. Thank you.